And you're all invited. Well, I think just women are invited. I think that's... I want to pray for women too. That's just terrible. All women are invited. Okay, I've stuffed it already. Invited to come along and pray. On the 13th, which is a Saturday, we have one of the best events we ever have in the church calendar. We have a working bee. Woo! Oh, thank you, my friend. There we go. He's going to be doing all the heavy lifting. Don't worry.
What? Used to me.
Yeah, you just lift some weights in the meantime, mate. It's okay. You'll get there. And next Saturday, the 6th of March, we have our Creating Safe Spaces training. So if you're involved in leadership in this church or in youth or children's ministry, this is our mandatory training that we have every year to make sure that we are doing everything we can right to create a great, safe and healthy environment for our kids to learn about Jesus. Okay, that's the announcements. I'm going to pray. Then we're going to praise God together. Oh, that's the last announcement, actually. If you are wearing a mask, you can sing today. There, okay, that's an exciting one. There you go. If you don't have a mask and you want to sing, put your hand up and someone will give you one of the paper ones. Yeah, that's great. Let's pray. Holy Father, I thank you so very much for this day. Lord, I thank you for the ability, Lord, to come here to open our hearts up to you in praise, in worship, Lord Jesus. Father, I just want to lay before you right now those in our church that just can't be present, that are joining us online or are otherwise sick or incapacitated, Lord Jesus. Lord, we know that you are a God of healing. We know that you can do mighty and wonderful things in our lives. So right now, Lord, we pray for them in faith and ask for healing on their bodies, their minds, their souls, whatever the healing is required, Lord Jesus. And Father, as we come to you with praise today, Lord, with the ability to sing from the bottom of our hearts and from the depths of our souls, Lord, I pray that in the midst of the worship, in the midst of the music, you would minister to our minds, our souls, our spirit, and draw us closer to Jesus today, in whose name I pray. Amen. Let's worship together. Stand and sing with us, if you've got a mask.
And if you don't, feel free to clap along and join it in your heart. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. Into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you lay down your life, that I would be set free. grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your sing for all that you've done for me. You were the Word at the beginning, one with God. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is, what a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is, nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the King. powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. Powerful name it is. The name of Jesus.
Good morning, those present, and of course those out there in cyberspace. We're about to just move into our communion time. You've all been handed the emblems just now, and of course if you're at home, just grab your juice or your bread or whatever it is you like to use to celebrate communion. It really doesn't matter what you use. It's the reason we celebrate, of course, that is important. I'd just like to share a word from Paul's letter to the church in Rome, and I'm looking at particularly at verse 5-6, and it says, while we were still helpless, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. And I love Romans chapter 5. It is a great text of scripture to share with the guys out at the prison when I do chapel, because it has all those sort of legal terms like justification. When you say to them, what's it mean to be justified, they normally understand what that means, because when they go before the magistrate, they have to justify their actions for what they did to determine what sentence they might get. But I love how the Apostle Paul parallels the two positions. First of all, he shares the good news, and he reminds the believers of who they are now, and particularly he wants to remind them that they are made just through their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And then he goes on to say that because you've been justified, you now have access to God's grace in which you now stand. And I like to imagine God's grace as a kind of a funnel by which he pours all his blessings into the life of the believer to empower them. That's how I like to describe grace. It's the means, his unmerited favour, by which he empowers the believer's life. But of course, beginning with this verse that I just shared, he then goes on to share the bad news. He talks about what they once were, and he uses words like sinners and ungodly, and being the enemy of God, being unrighteous, being separated from God for all eternity. And worst of all, he talks about being God's enemy. And I can imagine if you're going to pick a fight, it's very important that we don't pick a fight with God, because that is a battle we cannot win. And if you're here today and you're not justified by the blood of Christ, then I would just caution you and encourage you to put things right, because when we face him on Judgment Day, we want to be on his good side. Now, just getting back to this verse of scripture, I asked the guys in prison the other day at chapel, I said, for you guys, what does it mean to feel helpless? Now, the first answer I found kind of amusing given the complexities of prison life, but I think I'd get the same response in the general public. And you know what they said? Not having access to social media. Now imagine how bad that'd be, though. Imagine going a week without hearing Steve's sermons, or I'd be like not getting fed or not having a bath, okay? So a bit of a tragedy that'd be. So we couldn't listen to his sermons if we didn't have cyberspace. Good to have social media. The second two answers I kind of got, because they said they felt helpless because of loss of freedom. And in some ways, usually through their own fault, that's the reality of being in prison, but it puts you in a helpless situation because you can't control what goes on outside. So it's a very difficult position to be in, and there's always somebody there to tell you what to do. Every decision that you have to make during the day is made on your behalf, basically. And the third thing they talked about, surprisingly, was COVID, how this little virus that's unseen has taken such a grip on the globe and the people on this planet. So they talked about that as well. But thankfully, one of the Christian boys there brought it back to the true meaning of what's mentioned here and what we're celebrating today, because all those descriptive words that I described in the bad news, because of what Jesus has done, we no longer have to stay in that position. We no longer have to be God's enemy. We don't have to be sinful. We don't have to be ungodly or unrighteous. And most of all, we don't have to stand under God's anger. And that is definitely not, again, a position we need to be in. So it is fitting that we celebrate and be reminded of the helpless situation we're in until we ask Jesus Christ into our life and we're justified by his blood and came under his grace. So if you just have your emblems, if we just take the bread now, just symbolic, of course, of Christ's body that was given for us on the cross, our Lord and Saviour, who was sacrificed so that we could be set free. Now, if we just take the cup, this is to symbolise the blood that was given for you and me so that we can be justified or made just in God's sight and come under his unmerited favour or his wonderful grace and be empowered by him to give us that resource that we can have in no other way. So please let's just share together. And just as we reflect, I'm just going to pray to conclude. So please let us pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank you. Thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you that because of what you have done, we are now justified in Christ. Lord, we thank you for your grace that empowers us through your wonderful mercy. You empower us to live the life that you would want us to live. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Please join with us in worship, whether with your voice, if you're wearing a mask, or in spirit, as we sing It Is Well.
Peace like a river attendeth my way. When sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well. Trials should come, let this blessed assurance control, that Christ hath regarded my helpless estate and hath shed his own blood for my soul. It is well. This glorious thought, my sin. faith shall be sight. The clouds be rolled back as a scroll. The trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul. It is well, with my soul.
Quite a transition from "It is well with my soul." I'm going to pray. I think I'm going to open up the word and have a chat about it. Will you join with me? Holy Father, I want to thank you once again for drawing us here together, Lord, in person and online, to open ourselves up to you, to encounter you with worship, to enter into the throne room, and now, Lord, to open up your word and see how it might apply to our lives. Holy Father, as I speak this message this morning, Lord, I pray that all of my words come not from my lips, but from your heart and to your people. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. When I was a kid, I used to do this thing that I think a lot of kids do. I used to take everything apart to see how they worked. Who's done that when they were a kid? Yeah, okay. It was fun. I loved doing it. My parents didn't mind so much because it kept me occupied for a few hours. Well, they didn't mind until I took the television apart. Then it hampered their style just a little bit. I'd take something apart and then I'd try and figure out how it worked, and then I would put it back together, and 96% of the time, it all worked wonderfully. And I know a lot of kids do this. A lot of kids are curious and they open things up and they just want to understand the internals, know how things work. And for me, I'd go one step further than this. I'd take it apart, I'd check everything out, I'd put it back together, and then I'd start taking it apart once again. But I was doing it more purposefully this time. I'd take one component out at a time and see if the device still worked. I'd take one bit out, turn it on, yeah. Take another bit out, turn it on, yeah, it still works. And I'd take things out until it just stopped working. I was trying to find, I think, which components were critical to the operation of the device and which bits were superfluous. I guess I was searching for what part of this whole really makes a difference. Which are the essential parts? I mean, today you can get a job doing this. They call it component optimization. And if you're good at it, you can make a lot of money. You know? So if you're wondering about where to go at uni, you know, maybe that's a good career choice for you, just taking things apart and trying to break them. It is a bit of money. That's okay. That's not what I'm trying to talk about. The point is, sometimes you look at something and you say, what makes that thing tick? It could be a workplace, it could be a church, it could be your car. You know, what makes that thing tick? And we start to unpack, we start to undo it and take bits out. And you know, we ask the question, we look at something, we ask the question, is this something that makes a difference? Is this person, this product, this component worth including? Does it make it work? Does it make a difference? Or is it superfluous? Is it redundant? Is it unnecessary? Is it, in the word du jour at the moment, is it non-essential? You know, does this make a difference? You know, we've all gone through the COVID-19 ringer, and a lot of conversations I've been having with people are along these lines. You know, I don't know if I'm necessary in my workplace. I don't know if I'm making a difference in my home. I don't know what to do in church. We go through the COVID-19 ringer and we go, well, I don't understand who I am or my place anymore. And we start to ask hard questions, difficult questions. And one of those is, am I essential? Am I integral? If I didn't show up to this place, would I be missed? That's the conversations I've had with people, regardless of the context. It could be at home, it could be at work, it could be in your sports team, it could be in church. We can feel sometimes like we're an unnecessary cog in the machine, like we don't have a place and we're just happy to sit on the sidelines, happy to sit in the parts basket while the machine rolls on. And we see others using their gifts, others using their talents, and we think, oh, well, I'm no longer essential for the functioning of the whole. I'm just going to start sitting life out. And we get to moments like these. And I tell you, church, I confess, I've been in, had moments like that recently. You know, is this all there is to life? You know, am I essential in these parts of my life? And in these moments, I find Scripture so helpful. I find Scripture talks deeply into this moment. Scripture says this in Psalm 136. It speaks deeply into our lives. Scripture says, this is a psalm of a man called David who was going through a really hard time, who was convinced that maybe he wasn't essential anymore. And he pauses and he reflects with God and he has time to pray and to fast and to just center himself. And this is the conclusion he has in that moment where he was feeling redundant, left out and not needed. He says to God, you created my innermost being. He says, you knitted me together in my mother's womb. That God purposefully created you. That you are here for a reason. Say, I've got a reason. All right, we'll warm you up. I'm going to do this a lot today, church. You know, we're allowed to interact a little more. I'm going to get you interacting. You know, David writes, you know, God, I'm in this place. I'm stuck. I don't know where I'm going. I don't know if I'm essential. He says, he refocuses his mind. He says, you have created me. You knitted me together. You know who I am. You know what I've been created for. He says, because of that, I will praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Look at the person next to you and say, you're wonderful. Turn to the person on the other side and say, yes, I am. Yes, I am. I mean that, church. We need to own this today. You are fearfully and wonderfully made by your Creator. He has knitted you together in your mother's womb. None of those stitches were accidental. All the drop ones were there on purpose. He has created you. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. He has made you for a purpose to praise Him today. Say, I am wonderful. Own that. If you're online right now, put it in the comments. Say, I am wonderful. Make sure that's in your YouTube history forever. And people see it, they will know it's true. You know, we praise God because we're fearfully and wonderfully made. His works are wonderful. You are wonderful. I am wonderful. And I know that full well. Oh, here we go.
Can I move this because we can't see the screen?
Oh, okay. No worries. I guess we're not making a difference today. That's okay. No worries. Well, it's important you can see. There you go. I blame James. He moved it there this morning. I had it perfectly placed. You know, it's fearfully and wonderfully made too. It's in its right place right now. There we go. You know, there is what I love about this passage of Scripture is it does not put any expiration date on your wonderful nature. It doesn't say that you are fearfully and wonderfully made until you get to 30 years old, or 40 years old, or 50 years old. It doesn't say you're fearfully and wonderfully made until you reach retirement age. It says that you are fearfully and wonderfully made, that your Creator made you intentionally, and that you are made to make a difference, that God has created you with a purpose to praise His name. And we praise Him with what we think, what we say, and with what we do. We are made to make a difference in this world. You are not worthless. You are not superfluous. You are not a cog left out and doesn't need to be placed back in its spot. You are not non-essential. You are fearfully and wonderfully made by God and made to make a difference. You are an integral part of God's creation. God, you're an integral part of God's church. You are wonderfully made to make a difference. You agree? Say amen. Amen. That's true. God has fearfully and wonderfully made you. He has made you to make a difference. He wants to connect your salvation when you come to know Jesus to service, to doing things for Him. That is what our growth track is all about. If you've been with us a couple of weeks, I've been talking about the growth track. This thing on this box over here, I hope you can see it. If not, I'll get Trevor to hold it up in the air for us all. You know, it's wonderful. This is the growth track. This is the pillars that help guide us as a church. Now, we have a vision as a church, we have a mission as a church, and we have these four steps that help keep us on track. And those steps are to help people know God, find freedom, discover their purpose, and to make a difference, to connect salvation to service. That's where we're going as a church. That's where we're going as individual Christians. We don't put our hands up to Jesus and say, yes, I love you, Jesus, and then go back and sit in our seats and say, yes, I love you, Jesus. Now, what do you want me to do? Are you with me? Free people. Okay. I'm glad I'm doing this message then, because this is the point. This is the purpose. Let's get into it. You know, we are called to make a difference, to connect our salvation to service. We help people to know God. We create an environment here where people can receive life-giving worship and life-giving teaching. We create a space where people can find freedom in grace-filled groups. We create a space where people can discover their purpose by understanding who they are, their personality, and their spiritual gifts. And we take all of those things, we put them together, and we help you. That's you. That's you. Make a difference. To put your God-given nature, that fearfully and wonderfully made, that knitted together, to work for His service, so that we might praise His name, that we might see His kingdom come, that we might see His will be done in Maitland as it is in heaven. I wonder, church, do you remember the scripture I was harping on last week? There was one piece of scripture I was getting you to repeat back to me a bit. Let's see if you remember. Okay, I'll do the setup. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, it says this: a spiritual gift is given to each of us so that we can help each other. Oh, praise God, some people were listening. Oh, it makes me feel so good. And I know the rest of you just being quiet in your seat. This is what it says in the Word of God, that we're created for a purpose, we're made to make a difference, that we're all given spiritual gifts so that we can put them into practice, that we are all given spiritual gifts. Put your hand up if you've got a spiritual gift. Okay, if you don't, I'm telling you, God wants to give you one. He's got something planned for you. God, we have spiritual gifts so that we can help each other. We are made to make a difference. God gives us gifts, purpose, so that we can make a difference, to help one another. You are made to make a difference. And God has a place for you to serve, to share, so that you can impact the lives of others. And that's the kind of church that we are. We want to help you discover your purpose and put those purposes into action, to put you to work, to make a difference. Now, some people are just going, ooh, I don't know. I don't like the sound of that. You know, you're actually going to make me do something. Let me just put some context around that. If you're visiting with us today, it's so wonderful to have you here. I'm so happy about that. This is, what I'm talking about right now, is what makes our church tick. It's what makes it work. And I want to be upfront about this. I don't want to feel like you're baited and switched, that you come in and you just go, wow, this church is so wonderful. The people are so welcoming. Oh, I feel so loved. And you're on a roster. You know, that's not what I want you to feel. I don't want you to say, oh, okay, they're just getting me. They just want me in so I can put my nose to the grindstone. No, we believe that God has created you to make a difference. And as a church, it's part of our role to help you find that place to make a difference. It's not exclusively ours. It's yours as well. To dig in, to press into the Word of God, to press in prayer and ask Him, where can I serve? But as a church, we make no apologies to say that if you're part of us here, we want to see you experience the fullness of your relationship with God. And part of that is working your gifts for His purpose. God, a spiritual gift is given to each of us so that we can help each other. And so we have a strategy to do that in our church. We have a strategy to help you make a difference by finding a place to serve. And we do that intentionally here. That's why we do the spiritual gifts exercises. That's why we talk about this today, to help you find a place to make a difference. And it's wonderful. We've done for the last week and last year, we did some spiritual gifts identification exercises. That's really helpful. I want to show you what the result of that is. I'm not sure if you can read that very well online. Can you read it in the room? Okay, all right. I can see it pretty clearly. Okay, this is a beautiful graph, obviously not big enough, that looks at all the spiritual gifts that have been identified by people in our church. Now, we did those little questionnaires, and this is everything weighted together that people have in our congregation. And I think there's a wonderful diversity of gifts up here. You know, God has blended us together with a diversity of gifts to make a difference. Amen. You know, so many of us here, I love this, are gifted with mercy and service and the gift of exhortation, the gifts of help, the gifts of faith. That's wonderful stuff. There are people that God places here, and an abundance of them, that believe that God can do great and mighty things in this place. And there's people who believe that they can help make that happen. There are people who can come alongside others and help you when you are going through a rough time. I love this graph. And I'll email it out maybe during the week. If you want to get on the email address, talk to someone. Dawn, on the bottom of the contact sheet, there's an email address. Email me there and I'll put you on the mailing list so you can get this information. I love what this graph paints. It paints a picture of who our church is right now. And I believe it paints a picture that we are a church full of wonderful, caring, grace-filled people. We are a church full of people who have great faith to know that God is not slumbering, but He is at work and moving in people's lives. That we are a church so full of grace that people can't come here and not get to know their Creator. We're a church so full of grace that when you visit, and I pray this is true today for any visitors, that when you visit us, you feel the presence of God through other people's actions. Not COVID. But what this, let's just harp on this for a moment more. So we've got this half the graph, talks about mercy and service and exhortation and helps and faith and discernment and craftsmanship. And then you get alongside here, and what I see is something even better. It says that we're not just a church that is caring for people, we're a church full of people who can support that care in the community, that can support those in the rest of the church. There's people who are called to lead worship for administration. Thank goodness I'm so bad at that. It's great to have people gifted with administration. People who have gifts of prophecy that can see where God is leading us. You know, people are equally gifted in supporting the work of the gospel. Or maybe it's the other way around. Maybe we have pastors and teachers and apostles and prophets supported by people to help create a caring environment, a community-focused environment. But whichever way you look at the graph, whichever way we look at how God has knitted us together, what I do know for certain
is that when your gifts and when your actions are aligned, you will grow spiritually and God's kingdom will grow as well. Are you with me? When you align your gifts to service, it will benefit your life. You will grow spiritually. You'll see Jesus in ever abundant ways working through your life. And when we join together as well, when we are all using our gifts together, when we are knitted together for service, Jesus' church will grow. He can't not do it. Together, we can make a difference. God has made this church here to make a difference. And the way you do that is to find a place to serve. So I'm going to very shamelessly ask you something this morning. It doesn't matter if you've been in this church 5 minutes, 5 years, or you were here at its founding. I'm going to ask you something right now, and I want you to rest in it and ask God about this and about where it could be for you. I want to ask you today, church, including you guys who are joining us online, I want to ask you to join the team here, to be part of our church, to say, I am all in this place. I don't just want to come and sit on the pew and sit under some just fantastic preaching from a really handsome man. I don't want to just, oh, thanks, man, thanks for the woo. People laughed. Last of the coffee line, all right? We don't want to create a place where you can just feel comfortable sitting on the pew and as a cog that is on the shelf. Oh, I'm mixing all my metaphors now, but it doesn't matter. You know what I'm trying to say, church. We want to make this a church. We are not a passive recipient of grace, but a family who works together to spread the grace, to spread the goodness, to spread the forgiveness, the love of Jesus. James, the brother of Jesus, actually put this really bluntly. And I love his bluntness. So I'm going to be blunt here this morning. In James chapter 1, verse 22 to 25, if you've got your Bibles, get this out because you're going to want to underline this. This is food for life. This is good stuff. James, the brother of Jesus, chapter 1, verse 22. He says, but don't just listen to God's word. He's like, he's going to these churches and they've said yes to Jesus. They love Jesus. They've got the scripture. Someone's lent them some Torah scrolls. They've got some letters that are floating around and they've read them and they've gone, yeah, that's good stuff. And they said, and James goes, well, what do you mean that's good stuff? You need to put this in action and say, oh, no, that's great. He says, don't just listen to God's word. There's no point having your devotional time in the morning if you're not going to put it into practice. Are you with me? Okay, don't just listen to God's word. Don't let us just go in and be an intellectual exercise or maybe just fly out the other ear. Don't just listen to God's word. You must do what it says. You must do what it says. You need to put your faith into action. You need to connect your salvation to service. You need to identify your gifts and then help others. And so we don't just listen to God's word. This is something that is to affect our life in a positive way and to affect the lives of our friends and our family and our neighbors. Don't just listen to God's word. We must do what it says. Otherwise, and this is a bit harsh and this is really blunt, but I love it. Otherwise, you are only fooling yourself. You are only fooling yourself. You think you're invincible because Jesus is there. Yeah, you go, oh yeah, I read my devotion this morning. Yeah, nothing can hurt me. It's all good. You know, someone's bugging you and you go, yes, oh, I read that thing from the pastor who said, I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Get behind me. I don't know what that was. Geez, don't do that again, Stephen. That's really weird. You know, we say, take the word in and we use it as a shield when the word of God is a sword. We say, okay, I'm just going to cocoon myself up. I'm going to listen to the word. I'm going to let it make me feel good about myself, but we don't let it go any further. And James says when we do that, we just take the word of God and wrap it around us like some sort of shield, like a protective blanket, something to keep the world out. He says we are just fooling ourselves. There's no use to it. It doesn't edify. It doesn't make a difference. Verse 23 says, for if you listen to the word and don't obey it, it's like glancing at your face in a mirror. You see yourself, you walk away, and you forget what you look like. Who's ever done that? Yeah, no, I've never done that either. It's a weird illustration, James. But I have found myself doing one thing, and I do this all the time. Maybe this is what James means for today. Sometimes I pull my phone out, I look at the time, I put my phone back in the pocket, and then 2 seconds later, I pull my phone back out and look at the time again. You know, I pull it out and I don't observe it. I don't take it in to my life. And James says that faith without works, and we don't put it to action, it's like just glancing at your phone and not thinking about what you've seen. You can't act on that information. He says, you know, look carefully. But he said, you walk away, you don't know what it looks like. You don't know what yourself looks like. I think that's maybe important because we think about who we are in Christ. When we look in the mirror, we don't see ourselves, we should be seeing Jesus. When we look in the mirror, we should see Him at work in our lives, in our heart, changing and transforming who we are. And if we look in the mirror and we see Jesus, if we get that's there, what are we going to do? We're just going to serve ourselves. This sort of faith, church, is no good for anyone. Amen? It's no good for anyone. But James says this, but if you look carefully, if you look carefully into the perfect law that sets you free, and if you do what it says, and you don't forget what you heard, if you put it into action, then God will, what's it say? Bless you for doing it. When we read the word, when we absorb it, when we put it into action, we find that we live in a place of blessing. You know, this is what we're trying to do with our growth track, to help you know God, to find freedom, to discover purpose and make a difference, to find yourself in the place of blessing. Hallelujah. That is a place that God has created for you, that when you look at the word, that when you absorb it, when you put it into action, you find your place in it. You find yourself in His presence, in His blessing, doing God, what God made you for. This is how we praise God. The psalm said that I praise you, God, because I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. I praise you by putting into action those things that you have spoken into my life. I look at your perfect law and I put it into action. I do what it says. I don't forget about it. And I find myself right now in the place of blessing. James says a bit later, he says in chapter 2, verse 26, he says this, just as the body is dead without breath, just as we lie on the slab, so also faith is dead without good works. Faith is dead without good works. Now, we are saved by Jesus. There's nothing we can do. It is by His grace that we are saved, not by our own efforts, but by His pure sacrifice on the cross. We don't do anything to be saved, but Jesus says, that's not what I've saved you for. I've saved you for a life where you join with me and make a difference. It's important to me. It's important to our church. I want to take this to heart. God has planned good works for you. Turn to the person next to you, that's you. Oh, don't look so enthusiastic. I tried to deflect it to someone else. Okay, God has planned good works for you. Say, that's me. That's me. That's all of us here. He's called you. He's planned and purposed for you to bless your family, to bless your friends, to bless your neighbors, to help them be drawn into the kingdom of love and grace. So our strategy here as a church is to help you find a place to serve, to connect your salvation to service by understanding your gifts and putting you to work. So we want you to join the team, not under compulsion. Not because you feel guilty that you need to be doing it, but because you recognize and realize that your faith without deeds is dead, that God is calling you to a place of action that is a real place of blessing. Now, we are working with God to fulfill our mission. We want you to join the team, to find your place, to grow the kingdom. Just like it says in Romans, as our bodies have many parts and each part has a special function. So it is with Christ's body. There is no part that is not essential. There is no part that is superfluous. There is no part that can just sit on the shelf and just or sit on a pew. Just as it was Christ's bodies, we are many parts of one body and we belong to each other. This is our mutual responsibility. We love and serve and help each other. It's our mutual responsibility. You remember that bit. You won't remember anything else. Together we can do more than by ourselves. Every person here has a role. Every person is important. Every role is important. And I want to spend some time this morning just asking some people in our church who are putting their faith into action, just to talk about what they're doing today. I'm going to ask a few people. I'm going to start with, who's there? Dawn. Hey, Dawn, get out from behind the camera. Come up here, mate. Give him a clap. He's a handsome, handsome man. Thank you. Okay.
Morning, everyone.
I'm going to ask you a few questions, Dawn.
Yep, go ahead.
What's your shoe size?
My shoe size, 13 and a half.
Okay. How long have you been in this church?
Been in this church, I think a little over 2 years now. Yeah. So.
Oh, wow.
Maybe more.
That's a lot longer than I thought. Okay. Yeah. Well, that's fantastic. What a blessing to journey with you guys for so long. Yeah. Tell us a little bit about yourself. You got a family?
Yeah. So I have a family. I'm married to Erin Yip. We have three children. I'm working at Barrisfield. Just started 3 months ago. So and I'm a regular goer, and I'm also volunteering with the media and also kids club ministry. Yeah.
Very good. So you do a couple of roles here. So you do the stuff at the back.
That's
here,
right.
Which is wonderful and great.
Yep.
But you also, so Don and his wife Erin this year have picked up our Friday Kids Club and are leading it. So just tell us, give them a hand for that. That's fantastic.
So
tell us a bit about Kids Club.
Yep. So Kids Club is a children ministry run by Living Hope. So it's every Friday night from 5 p.m. to 6:30 p.m. It's catered for kindergarten to year six children in the age gap. So a typical Friday night would be plenty of games, often quite competitive games. And then we have some small like crafts and sort of little handcrafts and artwork, and followed by a short Christian message. So after that, we have a dinner. And yeah, it's just a nice little fun way to wrap up the school week for most of the kids. So I think, it's very, very special.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let me ask you this question. This is a little pointed. If you get this question wrong, I'm going to kick you out, okay? Does Kids Club make a difference?
I think so. I think Kids Club make a huge difference. First of all, it certainly creates a safe space for families from not only inside a church, but from a wider community to come visit on a Friday night, and it often helps start that conversation with them, regardless of the background they're coming from. They certainly feel safe when bringing the children here for an hour and a half. And I'm not sure if they've ever been attended to a church before, but they certainly feel very comfortable coming here and just letting the kids do their thing. And I think it's making a lot of impact to a wider community, and also the kids can talk to their friends about what they experienced last Friday night and had a great time, and it helps spreading the news and
awesome.
Spreading out that way, yep.
All right, last question. How can people help you make a difference with Kids Club? This is your big opportunity. Get some volunteers, mate,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so I strongly feel that God is doing something very special in this ministry, and there's certainly a growing number of kids going to our Kids Club. I think last week we had a shy 20 kids or something like that. So it's we're having a more demand, for different areas, not just with the message, or maybe you can volunteer in cooking or preparing some food, or even just in the administration team. We certainly can use a few volunteers to help during that time. Yeah.
Do you think you could use people praying for your ministry?
Absolutely, yeah. Praying is the strongest thing that we can ask for. Prayer is always welcome. Yeah.
Yeah. Prayer and cooking dinner for
kids.
That's
right, yeah.
Okay. Very good. Thank you, Don. Give him a hand.
Cheers.
All right. Hey, Jan, where are you? Yeah. Get ready, Kevin, you're next. Say, not happy, Jan.
Sometimes I am.
Jan is the person who runs our op shop, which runs... There you go. Tell us a little bit about the op shop.
The op shop, I must get into it and find out exactly how long ago it started, but it was started with a special...
No, we don't need the full history. Just tell us about what's happening now.
Okay. So at the moment we're open Monday to Thursday, 9:30 till 2. The plan is to open on Fridays again as long as I can get enough staff to work.
We'll get to that bit in
we're
a moment.
We're working on that one.
Who comes to the op shop?
Oh, many and varied. We have people that are into antiques and dealers and that, and then we get the people that come in that are so desperate for staff. It, you know, it's just over the whole board.
Okay. Where does the op shop fit into the vision of our church?
It's a service to the community. It helps with the finances. It helps with interacting with the community is very prominent.
It's probably fair to say that, you know, most people in our community meet us through our op shop before they would darken the door of church, wouldn't
it? Yes, yeah. But that they come into a part of the church and they don't feel unsafe.
Mm. Well, that's really important.
Or in their eyes, unsafe.
So, does the op shop make a difference?
Oh, I think so. We've had people come in that have needed help. Just before Christmas, a lady came in and needed stuff. She'd left an abusive relationship, and she's come in and we just said, right, pick what you need. Mm. And then it was just before Christmas because we had hampers, and I rang up whoever did those and said, please, can I have one? And yeah, so that person and family were very blessed, I think, by that.
But it's fair to say it's not actually an uncommon thing for someone escaping domestic violence to come to our op shop and we just load them up for...
Yeah. We just say, look, whatever you need, feel free.
So what's the last question? How can people help you make a difference through the op shop?
Like I said, I'm trying to get back to being open again on Fridays. I would really like to be able to get the shop working in a better way, to have an extra person every day just to help with stuff that's building up.
Very good. So there's someone who is young or something like that, it'd be great to have just a bit of extra...
Yes, we did with COVID, had a few people that aren't coming back. Mm. And so it would be good to fill those places again.
Very good. Thank you for helping make a difference in this church, Jan.
You're welcome.
Change of pace. Hey, Kevin, where are you, mate? Come up here. Tell us a bit about what you do in this place, Kevin.
Okay, thank you. Together with Colin Potts and Mark Reason, we meet once a week, weather permitting, and look after the lawns, the general property outside. If you imagine your own house, you'd need to keep on top of those sort of things just so it looks respectable in the community. Our church is just a big family home, our church home.
Amen.
So it's important for us to keep it appearing in a good state of appearance because, you know, if it's a neighbour or someone, they've got long grass and bushes and shrubs and everything falling over, you think, oh, my property value is going down, or there's some sort of vermin or something going to come out of there and whatnot. So as a church here, we're in a central place in the community, and we've got a responsibility, I think, to maintain the place in a good way, appearance-wise, but also, of course, if we let all the neighbouring bush and stuff encroach, and you know, we could have, you know, all sorts of things, snakes. Nothing worse than having a snake in your
Ex-lay place. On the bad things, or just keep it light, keep that's it light. Right.
Yeah, so anyway, that's basically what we do. And Cliff, he's the property manager, so he's often here as well doing other things. So it's all very important to make sure that we are able to help in that respect. So I'm very happy to be able to, you know, give some of my time. I was encouraged when I stopped work. Peter Donald, who used to come while Trish was looking after the op shop, he used to spend some time largely by himself early on. Then he asked if I could help him, and when Pete left, he said, make sure you keep coming. So, yeah, and so, as I say, I'm very happy to have Colin and Mark helping as well.
All right, you've covered basically all my questions, but if I can summarise that in a couple of words, and say, it might tell me if I'm getting this right. Taking care of this place reflects on people who come, that they think, yeah, if a place looks like rubbish, they think that we probably won't care, but if it looks cared for, they might think that we would care for them.
That's right. I mean, if we give an appearance of being there for the community and being able to, you know, look after our own selves, hey, there's a good chance that if they become involved, that they'll also get cared for. So, yeah.
I like that image, yeah. So you've basically answered all my questions about me asking, except this last one. How can people help you and the team make a difference?
Okay. There's always need for extras because, you know, volunteers run so many things in our society. And when someone falls away or is unable to help for some reason, it's hard to get someone else to come in. So we've got big jobs and little jobs. And one of the things we notice when we're spending our time here is last week particularly, there's grass and there's weeds coming up in the garden, and people spent a bit of time some months ago putting a few more shrubs and things in. And a lot of those have died because they didn't get enough water. That was before we got the recent rains. But yeah, there's all these things. And you can come and spend, you know, half an hour, or if you drop someone off to do something, you come and just spend a little time or a bigger amount of time if you're able. There's, you know, there's always something you can do, and if you need to get access to any of the tools and things, there's always someone who's got a key to the shed, unless the place is closed, then there's alarms and things as well. So, yeah, we're always looking for help. We can't in our time spend, you know, a lot of it going and doing a whole day's work. It's fairly hard on you when you get a bit older too. So
very good.
That's it.
Thank you for making a difference. Thank you. Last one. Emerald, come up here. Emerald loves to talk in public. Yeah. So Emerald is one of our worship leaders, and a wonderful one at that. Tell us, Emerald, why do you think worship makes a difference?
Why worship? Why worship makes a difference? Because worship is a lifestyle, and we are born to worship God.
That's good.
Well, it's a very special moment, like especially when we're together worshiping, because like 7 days a week we get exhausted during the week, and when we come here we worship God, be in His presence. Correct me if I'm wrong, and I firmly believe, they won't correct me anyway, that you feel refreshed and God reveals you new things, and that makes you prepared for the next week.
So you think worship makes a difference?
Very much, yes. They can even testify, Stephen, if you like.
Well, yeah. You know, I don't think it's a hard sell, to be honest. But the big question is, how can people help you make a difference?
Yes, I've got a few points, actually.
Okay, I'll sit down.
Obey, participate, keep participating. And I guess that's those three. So the first one... what did I say again? Obey, isn't
it? Obey, yes.
Obey, so...
That's your point.
Yes, hey. Obey. Keep saying yes to God. I know everyone feels a bit, that's worship, like, how do you do that? But it never goes wrong. If you've got the heart to obey, you'll do everything because we love God. Amen?
Amen.
And participate. When we're in the presence of God, we're not spectators. We are participating because that's our expression. of our love and everything for Him and keep participating. Worship is not just the time where we stand up and sing. We are here to unite, but when we go out of the church, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, we participate. We have those moments of worship as well. So what I've said earlier, worship is a lifestyle. So when you wash the plates, you clean your car, you do everything, we do it for God. And I really encourage everyone to have that special moment where you don't do any household chores or anything. Just have that moment with
God.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Did I sorry. Make sense?
No, yeah, it does. Yes, I was making a
now
joke.
I'm forgetting
I ruined your flow. I'm sorry. Welcome, Emerald. Tell us about
Anyway, have that special moment. Like, you just take time and be still. Lord, just talk to Him. Because He will talk to you, that's for sure. Read the Word of God, pray, and be still, and you'll hear that voice. Keep participating, yeah. And that's it. And if you've got, and if you feel you've got the gift of worship or some, yeah, along those lines, keep praying. You can talk to Stephen, you can talk to Penny. And I'm not saying it's just for the young ones, it's for everyone, because worship is for
Amen.
Everyone. Amen.
Yeah. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Shouldn't have finished on someone that's better than me. Okay. I'm sorry for interrupting you as well. So let's just wrap this up then. So the growth track in our church exists for a purpose. It's to connect our salvation to service, because we believe that God has gifted you for a purpose, and that purpose is to make a difference. And so I guess there's some really clear next steps here. And I know you're going to get the first one without me trying, and that is, we want you to join the team here. We want you to say, I don't want to sit on the pew, even though I'm 8 or 80 years old. I want to be participating. I want to be joining together with everyone else. And there is a place for every single person, a place for every single gift. It doesn't matter if you're gifted with hospitality, we could use you on the door or behind a coffee machine, or if you've got administration, praise God for that, to help get rosters and all of that stuff done, for gifts of help to draw us all together to help lift our ministries. I've got like 20 written here. I'm not going to read them all. But it covers everything in the life of our church, from creating a life-giving Sunday service, to creating grace-filled life groups, to helping people understand and discover their purpose, and to walking alongside others as they make a difference with you. If you have gifts, they are there to help. If you have gifts, they are there to help each other. So what my encouragement then is to serve others with your gifts. And it's to realize that salvation is not just for you. Salvation is a gift that we share with others. It's a way of life, as Emerald said, you know, worshiping God, praising Him. You know, I praise you, God, for I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. You are gifted to make a difference in every part of your day. So serve others each day. You know, walk in your unique sphere of life. There is no, you are completely unique in the connections you have with others. Yeah, the circle of your friends, the circle of your family, the circle of your neighbors. There's no one else that has that same influence in other people's lives. And God has not brought you into their lives accidentally, but to be a light, to show His love and to serve them, to help them with your gifts. And I guess I should say, I've talked about using our gifts in the context of the church, and we want you to join the team. What do I want you to do? Very good. All right, you're on the team now. Very good. You're vocal. That's it. But using your gifts is not constrained to this place. It's an unconstrained activity. It is there to share with everyone that you meet. And to do that effectively, you need to do this one thing. You need to be prayerful. You need to pray about the circles that you're walking in, the circles that you're gifted to serve in. To use your gifts in the church or in the world, you need to have spiritual eyes about where God is leading you. Amen? and to have our spiritual eyes, we open ourselves up to God in prayer. If you want a gift, if you want to serve, if you're unsure about it, if you're like, I've got a gift and God's not using it, the way to use that gift, the way to activate it, the way to walk in the blessing of that gift is to pray to God and ask Him to provide situations for you to use it. Here is a prayer. I promise every time you pray this prayer, God will answer it. Every time you offer this up to God, He will respond. Open your heart up to God and pray. Holy Father, show me where to use my gifts today. Amen. Pray that prayer and God will answer it. You might not like the answer. It might get you into trouble. It might get into sticky situations. But when you open yourself up to God in prayer, when you ask Him to lead you, when you ask Him to show you where to use your gifts, I promise you, He will answer that prayer and He will lead you into the place of His blessing. And that's all I got. That's all I got. Next week, we're going to have a guest speaker, so you get a break from me talking about this stuff. Hey, worship team, come up. Come and bless us in a moment. You know, but I want to make an invitation to you today. And it's this. I don't know where you are in life right now. I don't know if you are feeling integrated. I don't know if you're feeling like a cog. I don't know if you're feeling useful or otherwise. I don't know if you're feeling essential or non-essential. But wherever you are in your life, we know that we serve a God who can open us up to bring change and transformation. So if you are struggling, if you don't know where you fit, if you want to find a place to serve, or you just want to feel a fresh touch of God's love and grace of mercy, we are here today to listen and to pray over your lives. We believe that prayer changes lives. Amen? When we open ourselves up to God, He brings change and transformation. So we're going to finish on a worship song, and then we're going to have some wonderful tea and coffee and stuff outside. We'll have a wonderful barista in the machine. Praise God for that blessing, a gift of help and service right there. But if you need prayer, if you need to get through something and you're not sure how, I'm going to wait down the front here. I'm ready and willing to listen and pray. We've got Dave, one of our elders. Dave, give a wave. You see this wonderful looking guy here? He's an elder of our church. He'd love to listen to you. He'd love to pray for you. And if it's not one of us, just turn to the person next to you and say, hey, will you pray for me now? Because I know prayer can bring change to my situation. Let's worship.
That the highest King would welcome me. I was lost, but He brought me in. Oh, His love for me. Oh, His love for me. Whom the Son sets free, oh, is free. He has ransomed me, His grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, He died for me. Whom the Son sets free, always free. Child of God, yes I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who You say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who You say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. There's a place for me. I'm a child.